Hello everybody and welcome to my channel today. We're continuing on with kitchen staples and flavorings, and today we're going to talk about salt and pepper.
Yo, I don't think we should talk about this.
Come on, why not?
People might misunderstand what we're trying to say, you know?
No, but that's a part of life.
So let's get started. So just a heads up, this video is heavy on salt. All right, so first of all, salt is a mineral that is primarily sodium chloride. Salt is considered to be a founding contribution to the development of human civilization. The earliest known harvesting of salt can be dated back to 6000 BCE, where it is believed to have occurred at Lake Yincheng in the Chinese province of Shaanxi. Salt has a rich history of trade that can be dated back to 2800 BCE. The use of salt as a political tool due to its economic importance was used for everything from starting wars, colonial liberation, and societal control. Salt, or sodium chloride, is part of a larger classification of salts. From a health perspective, salt is an essential nutrient for the human body, including maintaining and regulating fluid balance in the body, as well as blood cell fluid. It also helps with the absorption of nutrients in the small intestine, as well as respiration and digestion. Without salt, we would not be able to transport nutrients or oxygen, transmit nerve impulses, or move muscles, including the heart. One thing that's added to modern table salt is iodine. And iodine is added to salt to prevent iodine deficiency. Iodine helps prevent harmful bacteria from multiplying in the intestines, as well as create the hormones that regulate heart rate and blood pressure. Not getting enough iodine in your diet can lead to enlarged thyroid glands, which is known as a goiter. Iodine is found mainly in animal protein foods and sea vegetables, and in fortified foods such as seaweed like nori, kelp, kombu, and wakame, fish, shellfish like cod, canned tuna, oysters, and shrimp, eggs, beef liver, and chicken. During prehistoric times, people ingested iodine through the consumption of sea animals such as clams, oysters, shrimps, fish, and other hunted animals. As agricultural humans developed and grains and vegetables became staples of the Neolithic human diet, iodine deficiency started to become a problem. From a culinary perspective, salt is essential to tasty dishes. Food preservation using salt draws out bacteria causing moisture, and this was first discovered by the Egyptians, who also used salt in mummification, dyeing clothes, curing hides, and healing wounds. In addition to using salt for preservation, salt is also used as a seasoning. Salts enhance and bring out natural flavors of food items. I'm gonna put up on the screen and then also in the description below the ratios of salt to use in certain food items, such as water for boiling pasta, or how much to use on raw meats to achieve the perfect balance. This may be the most important, as far as culinary information goes, the most important part of this video. This diagram will also be put on my website, www.cookingwithfrankie.com. Salt can even be added to desserts. Adding a salt to a citrus dessert can make the citrus fresher, more puckery, and cinnamon, ginger, and nutmeg more fragrant. There are a number of different kinds of salts in addition to the kind that we consume. One of the most notable is potassium nitrate. Potassium nitrate is an inorganic crystalline salt known as KNO3 and is used in making gunpowder, fertilizer, and medicine. As far as edible salts go, there are a wide variety of edible salts, and they are as follows. Table salt, which is generally to be avoided as it is the highest processed version of sea salt. Sea salt, or mined salt, is commonly known as rock salt. It possesses a higher level of other important minerals like potassium, iron, calcium, and zinc. Cooking salts are salts meant to be added before and during the cooking process. They include sea salt, kosher salt, iodized, coarse salt, pink Himalayan salt, or Peruvian salt. Then there is pickling or canning salts. And pickling or canning salts are pure fine ground salt. They do not contain any anti-caking ingredients, such as the case with other sea salts and cooking salts. Anti-caking ingredients, which can turn pickling liquid cloudy. They also don't contain additives like iodine, which can make pickles dark. Kosher salts and sea salts are suitable swaps for pickling salts, as they do not contain anti-caking ingredients or iodine that can discolor the pickling liquid or the pickling ingredients. Curing salts are not edible salts. Curing salts contain a high amount of nitrites and cannot be used like regular salt because nitrites are toxic. The two main kind of curing salts are Prague number 1 and Prague number 2. These two curing salts cannot be interchanged. Prague number 1 is a curing salt used in preserved meats that require cooking, brining, smoking, or canning. For meats such as poultry, fish, ham, bacon, luncheon meats, corned beef, and pâtés. Prague number 2 is for dry cured meats that do not require cooking. Meats such as pepperoni, hard salami, prosciutto hams, dried sausages, and other products that not only do not require cooking, but also do not require smoking or refrigeration. Seasoned cooking salts are simply salts that have had herbs or spices mixed in to create a flavor profile. Finishing salts are salts that are meant to be added at the end of cooking or right before serving, and they have a couple different functions in addition to adding flavor and taste. Sometimes they are used as a garnish. Salts used as garnish are typically larger in size than other salts. There are a number of different amazing finishing salts, and they include the following. Fleur de sel is probably one of the most popular garnishing salts, and it is harvested by hand from salt ponds in the Gironde region of France. Next, we have some colored salts, and these colored salts are not colored because of any additive. They are of different colors because of the minerals that are within them. There's some really exciting ones. We'll start with Persian blue diamond salt, which comes from a single seam running through an ancient salt lake bed in Iran, formerly Persia. Most specifically, the Kashim Island, which is home to the Namekagan Salt Dome and Salt Cave. Gray salt is harvested in the coastal region areas of France and is harvested using a traditional wood rake method. The color of gray salt is slightly gray or purple. Flaky pink Himalayan salt is found in the foothills of the Himalayan mountain range. This unpolluted pristine salt contains over 80 trace minerals to match our bodies' needs. And then there are a number of black salts, well, three to be specific, and they include Cyprus black salt, Hawaiian black salt, and Indian black salt. And Indian black salt is the most significant of the three black salts. Then there are smoked salts, which are cold wood smoked. The most common choices for these salts is alder, applewood, hickory, mesquite, and oak. The Hawaiian alaya, which is harvested from the Hawaiian island of Kauai and is red in color. Kona deep water sea salt comes from the depths of about 2,200 feet off the Hawaiian coastline and is then evaporated in the sun. This sea salt is white in color. Alaskan flake sea salt is harvested directly from the waters around Sitka, Alaska. New Zealand Lake Grasmere salt is harvested from the depths of the ocean and evaporated in seaside ponds surrounding Lake Grasmere. At the end of the summer, the salt crusts is lifted from the bottom of the ponds. Korean sorghum salt is used for making kimchi. The salt is solar evaporated on a small island off the coast of Korea and is in a block shape. Sal de Gusano is a traditional Mexican salt made by toasting dried worm larva and grinding it with rock salt and chili peppers. This salt is used as a smoky seasoning accompaniment to mezcal. which is an alcoholic drink. It is traditional in the Oaxaca region of Mexico. And then finally, we have Arctic sea salt from Arctic waters that have been passed by the Benguela Current near the west coast of Africa, and then dried by the sun and offshore winds while passing through an underground aquifer. Storage for salt is much like the storage for any spice or herb or anything in the kitchen. Airtight container, dark location, cool temperatures is gonna be the best. If you purchase your salt in bulk, it is recommended that you break it up into smaller containers and store it, mostly because the longer a salt is exposed to the air, the more moisture it's gonna pick up and the more hard it's gonna get, and it's not gonna be a great product. Oxygen absorbers are recommended for long-term storage. Next, we're moving on to pepper. And this is just, this isn't peppers. This is the pepper used in the kitchen as a spice. Pepper, or piper negrum, originates from southern India and has been cultivated there for thousands of years. According to archaeological evidence and recorded history, the first recorded use of pepper that has been identified dates back to at least 2000 BCE. And pepper was one of the first commodities traded between the Orient and Europe. And pepper was associated with the higher class people. And in some instances was used as currency for paying things like taxes and rent and dowries. And a dowry is a good property or money paid by a bride's family to the husband or his family. It was associated with luxury and elite classes and was a driving force behind the discovery of the Americas by the Portuguese and Spain. The purpose of pepper in the kitchen is for seasoning and flavoring a wide variety of meats, vegetables, and fruit. Most notably, meats, sausages, fish, vegetables, salad dressing, stock, soups, stir fries, pastas, marinades, and in pickling. Added to dessert, it can be quite nice. Pepper has also been used for health benefits, as it's a powerful antioxidant, boosts nutrient absorption, and may promote digestion and prevent diarrhea. Pepper is also used as a decongestant and as pest control. There are a number of different kinds of peppers, but the most common are tillicherry and lampong. Tillicherry comes from India and has a fruity to grassy flavor and distinct freshness. Lampong comes from southern Sumatra and Indonesia and has an intense heated punch of citrus and pine aromas. There are a number of different types of peppercorn designations, and they include black, white, green, and pink, and Szechuan. The definitions of these are as follows. A black peppercorn is picked when not quite ripe, then dried to a black or brown color. This is the strongest flavor of pepper. White peppercorns are allowed to ripen. Their skin is removed, their berry is dried. They are smaller, smoother, and lighter tan, and milder in flavor. Green peppercorns are underripe, soft, and preserved in brine. Green peppercorns have a fresh flavor and are less pungent. Pink peppercorns are not of the Piper Negrum family. Pink peppercorns are the dried berry of the Peruvian or Brazilian pepper trees, which are actually part of the cashew family. So, storage of peppercorns depends on the type of peppercorn that you have. Whole peppercorns can be stored sealed in their package for up to 1 to 3 years. Ground pepper, once open and exposed, starts to lose its flavor at about 4 months. Brined peppercorns should be refrigerated after opening and used after 1 month. And water-packed peppercorns should be refrigerated upon opening and should be used within 1 week. I think that's all for salt and pepper today. I hope you learned something. I hope you heard about a salt that you would like to seek out. If you have any questions about anything in this video, please send me a message or comment in the comments below. If you haven't started following this channel yet, please consider doing so. Thank you for watching this video. And as always, have a wonderful day.
Hey, what's doing? What's doing, baby? Oh, don't show your butt. Put your butt away.
According to Oh, why can't I say that? Archaeological. Mm. Archaeological.